So, a few days ago, we put up a couple of posts about our tap cocktails, and a whole bunch of you asked us a bunch of questions about how we approach it, how we make our tap cocktails. And so we took all those questions and we thought that, fuck it, we're just gonna do a video about our whole procedure. And this is that video about our whole procedure. Doesn't get any more straightforward, simple than that. All right, now, before we go into the technical aspect of it, let's cover the basics. We'll go through the budget, the things that you'll need, and how long it takes to make these tap cocktails. If you want to have one keg and start doing around 100 cocktails a day, the whole system will only cost you around 300 to 400 euros, and you'll probably make that back in one day of selling a bunch of cocktails. There's only four things you'll need to start making tap cocktails. The first thing is a Cornelius keg. This is a Cornelius keg. And they're steady as fuck. Essentially how it works is very easy. It's got these two little noggins over here. One of them puts in gas and the other one takes out the liquid and, you know, feeds it to you. And then you have this little thing where you can just basically release the pressure. And then when you want to fill it up, you just open that thing up and you have an unlimited amount of refills to this keg. So you can empty it and refill it as many times as you want. The second thing you'll need is a CO2 barrel. This is a CO2 barrel. They're usually heavy as fuck. A lot of bars have them around to give gas to your beers. And you can find them practically anywhere. They're also quite cheap. They're around 100 euros to buy a full one, so should be good to go. The third thing you'll need for your tap cocktail ensemble is a line out tube. I don't know the official name for it. It kind of looks like this. You can find it on Amazon, and I will include the name in the description probably. They cost around 15 euros, 20 euros. You'll put this on the keg, and then you can just pour out your cocktail with that. Now, obviously, you can upgrade this, make this more beautiful, get it in a proper tap, but this is for you to start pouring up your cocktails at a house party or wherever the fuck you want to. Where do you pour up tap cocktails? And the last and probably one of the most important items that you'll need is another thing that I don't know the name for, a gas 2B thingy. Again, name's in the description. And it basically looks like this. You'll connect this onto your keg and you connect this little thing into your CO2 barrel and you'll give it gas. Now, why I say that this is the most important thing is because you need to get a slightly nicer one where you can kind of regulate the PSI with a level and where you can turn it on and off with this level, because that's going to be a major thing that you're going to need whilst making these tap cocktails. So we're going to be making one of our signature cocktails. It's called a strawberry kush. And it's basically a strawberry mojito with a bit of Sichuan, a bit of salt, and some cardamom. Okay, so the first ingredient we're going to add is our strawberry rum. Now you can either use a funnel or you can just get a massive jug like this, which is what I use. You just add it to it and it makes it easier to pour it into the Cornelius keg. We're gonna add our second rum because for this drink we do a rum blend. What we did is that we did a Sichuan rum and we did a strawberry rum, and then we figured out the balance of Sichuan to strawberry by blending those two rums until it hit the sweet spot. And then we're going to add our mint syrup. Just a whole bunch of mint. It's basically dehydrated mint and mint tea. We use both of it, and then we kind of make a nice dope scissor. And we're not adding the citrus yet. We're gonna get to that in a little bit, but when we keg this cocktail, it's not going to be with the citrus. Then we're going to add a mix of our salt solution and our bitters. We actually add them straight into the keg. I know I did that because I could have just poured that in. Right, cool. And the last thing that we're going to add, this is a mojito and this is going to be carbonated. So instead of adding soda water, we use the reverse osmosis filtered water and we just add the water to it. We don't add it as dilution, but this is just our way of making the soda water inside of the keg, which saves a lot of money as well. That's it. You guys can't see this right now, but this thing is basically up until here with liquid. And we're probably going to be able to make between 120 and 140 cocktails with this little bad boy. It's not gonna need a lot of work. So now that all our ingredients is in the keg, we're just gonna make sure that the seal is on and make sure that it's nice and tight because you don't want any of those bubbles to escape. So I'm just gonna put the seal on. So we make sure to put it in and you get this little kind of rubbery piece over here. And you wanna make sure that it's all even here and not crooked. And then you kind of put it in so it's nice and tight. And there we go. Now we can start adding the gas. All right, so now that we have all our ingredients here, we're gonna add this little thing onto the gas barrel and we're gonna start charging up the cocktail. Now, I prefer to do this on the floor. That's why we changed the vibe here. Okay, cool. Boom. Okay, there we go. So this is why I told you later that this is one of the most important things, because here's where we're gonna see where we get our PSI. And the PSI is the amount of pressure of CO2 that we'll be putting into this keg. And then we hook this up. I don't know if you can, shit, I'll drop this thing. I don't know if you can hear that. I took the mic out. Already hear the gas going in as soon as you do that. And what you wanna do is that you just wanna start and look at this and make sure that it's all the way up at around 50 PSI. We just wanna take this thing up until it goes to around 50 PSI. There we go. Right, so you've hooked up the gas now, and what the next step is basically what's going to be the most important step when it comes to making sure that those bubbles in your drink are amazing. This is a method we call the in and out method. Imagine if we did this, but with no animations. That'd be great, right? What we want to do is that we want to do a cycle of 5 or 6 times of putting in gas whilst taking out air. Now the gas is coming in right here and it's coming in from the top. So not a lot of gas is actually going through the entire thing, right? So what we want to begin with doing is that we want to put on the gas, tilt the keg, give it a little roll. We want to put the keg back down and then we want to release out all the pressure and all the air. And we're going to do this about 6 times. And through this method, you'll basically slowly put in more CO2 and take out more air. Put in more CO2 and take out more air. More CO2, take out more air. And you'll slowly carbonate it more and more until it hits just that, you know, that spot. So the gas is on, it's on 50 PSI, we're all good. Now, what we're gonna want to do is that we're gonna want to take up the keg and we're gonna want the liquid to cover where the gas is going in. So now the gas is going straight into the liquid basically, right? And what we wanna want to do is that we're gonna want to roll it. You don't need to shake it heavy or all like that. We're just gonna roll it like this for about 10 seconds. After that, we're going to put it down and then we're gonna turn it off. Just take that thing off. And we're basically going to release the pressure. And what we're gonna do now is that we're gonna turn it back on. And so what you need to do is that between every one, when you've put it back on, you just need to wait until it gets up to 50 PSI again. Now, we usually put it up to 50 PSI. It's different though. Like if you don't want your drink to be that carbonated, you can choose 40 or 30. If you want it to be a bit more carbonated, you can choose more. 50 PSI is a measure that for us is kind of like an all-purpose measure. It works for gin tonics, for spritzes, for most highballs and mojitos and cocktails like that. So we're at 50 again now, and then we're going to roll it again. And that's it. We're gonna do this for about 5 or 6 times.
What number is this?
Last one, number 6. Woo! We take it off and we release the pressure. All right, so it's a bit of a workout. After you've done that for 6 times, we usually put on the gas on a steady 50 PSI, And now we let it rest. We let it rest from everything between 6 to 8 hours, and then it will come out consistently doing 100 or so cocktails with a good amount of bubbles. And this is another shorter one, so I'm just gonna put this one on. We're gonna put that one on right there. And then we're gonna take a little tasting glass, and then we can just... pour up a little carbonated liquid right there. Kablammy, look at that, eh? There you go, that's it. That's all you need to do to carbonate a cocktail. It's as simple as this little thing right here if you wanna start. And then you just add Cornelius kegs and you just add tubes to your one gas thing. Now we haven't added citrus and we haven't talked about temperature, but I thought just after this, we're just going to do an FFAQ with some of the most frequently asked questions by you guys that you guys DM to me. And we're just gonna go through those questions real quick. I'm just gonna give you all our answers for how we approach them.
Dilution. What's the deal with dilution?
So the way we approach tap cocktails is that most of our tap cocktails are usually highballs and we don't add dilutions. They're either topped up with tonic or soda or however we do it. So we add that amount and then we carbonate it. And then we usually always pour it over ice. However, if you want to do a carbonated cocktail and you want to serve it up, you just measure up your dilution and do it like that, but it will come out fizzy. Just to let you know.
What's the deal with temperature?
The colder your liquid is, the more CO2 you can push into it. It's kind of, if the limit is this much CO2 when it's like, you know, 10 degrees Celsius, it goes up to here if you bring it down to 2. So when we prep all our liquids, we put them inside of our walk-in fridge. And when the kegs are sitting before their tap, they sit inside of a fridge. So where the kegs are, it's always around 2 to 3 degrees Celsius, and we keep it as cold as possible to keep it as carbonated as possible. Very simply, the colder, the better.
Ingredients, what you can or cannot use.
The only ingredients that I would say that we don't use is citrus juices and kind of dairy cream milk. The creamy milky stuff is because it just gets too messy in the systems. And the citrus juices we don't use because after a couple of days, it gives this kind of metallic flavor and we really don't like it. The super easy solution in what we do with the strawberry kush is that we just add the citrus in the glass and then ice, and then we just pour the drink up. It's very, very simple to do so. On the other side of that, you got things like watermelon juice, which usually goes bad in 24 hours, but if you put it in a tank and carbonate it, it'll be good for 2 weeks. So I would say experiment a lot with a lot of juices, and you can experiment the way we do, which is with a 1.5 liter ISI. So we do our cocktails in the small ISI, and then once it's passed the ISI test, then we do it times 100 or times 150.
When are you releasing your own range of fizzy cocktails?
As soon as we...